خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. Honorable ulama, beloved brothers and listeners, tonight we have completed the 18th para of the Quran. Falhamdulillahi ala dhalik. Indeed, it is impossible to translate every single verse of these paras that we are reading every night. The idea, as I have mentioned before, is to highlight a few verses of the Quran, just to awaken us from within and to give us the feeling that indeed we have listened to the Quran, the word of Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. This surah is named after the believers. He opens the verses describing who are the successful ones. Successful are the believers. He says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Successful are the believers. Who are they? They are the ones who concentrate in their salah. Concentration in salah is one of the most difficult things we have. There is a hadith wherein it is reported, يُوشِكُ أَن تَدْخُلَ مَسْجِدَ جَمَاعَةٍ فَلَا تَرَى فِيهِ رَجُلًا خَاشِعًا. Very soon there will be a time that you will enter a masjid where jama'ah is going on and there will not be a single person concentrating in salah. Not one person will be concentrating in his or her salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep shaitan away from us. Whilst we are fulfilling our salah, shaitan comes to us and makes us think of so many things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. So, if Allah has granted us the power of concentration in salah, it is a very, very great gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to thank Him for that. And if He has not, then indeed we need to firstly stay away from sin. Secondly, increase durood sharif upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And thirdly, repeat A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim as many times as you can. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to mention the qualities of the believers. The first one is the one we mentioned. الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. The second one. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. Those who do not engage in vain talk. When there is vain talk, they literally go away from there. How many of us engage in vain talk? Unnecessary talk. Speech that does not benefit us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. Imam Ghazali rahimahullah has said that there are four types of speech. The first is that which is only beneficial. The second is that which is only harmful. The third is that which has more harm than good. And the last is that which has more good than harm. So he mentions that the three categories we can do away with them. They are unnecessary. Just one category, that which has only good in it, that we should engage in. Therefore, we should cut our speech by three quarters and only engage in one quarter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to control this tongue of ours. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains the story of Nuh alayhi salam, and there is just one point I wish to raise from here. The people said about Nuh alayhi salam, in huwa illa rajulun bihi jinnah. Indeed, he is a man who is possessed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from accusing people of being possessed. Not only that, may He save us from feeling that every sickness we have, there is something to do with jinn or jadu or something to do with ayn or nazar as we know it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. 9 times out of 10, it is a medical illness. It does not have anything to do with these superstitious things. But shaitan comes to us and makes us say the same thing that was said to the anbiya alayhimus salatu wassalam. There is a jinn. Why? Because we don't know how to solve this problem. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from all these difficulties, and may He indeed grant us strong iman that we understand what is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what He has decided and decreed. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to mention the plight of the person, the plight of the criminal whom, when death comes to him, what does he say? Allah describes this and Allah says, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتُ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ. When death comes to one of them, what do they say? We've heard it in the previous ajza. Oh Allah, let us go back. Let us go back to earth. لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا. So that I can do good deeds. Did we not hear this verse repeating itself in different words throughout the ajza that we have read? Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding myself and yourself about death
And this particular surah as well has vivid descriptions of death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an easy death. The obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what is called for in the entire Quran. If we obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have achieved everything. If shaitan gets hold of us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, don't lose hope. So long as you have not died, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance. One of the verses of Surah An-Nur, the next surah that we read tonight, Allah says, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. And turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all you believing men and women, so that you can succeed. What is success? Success lies in turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, turning to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah grant us this turning before we die. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا. Do you think that we have created you for nothing, for no apparent reason? وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. And do you think that you are not going to return to us? Nay, indeed we are going to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then in Surah An-Nur, the surah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has expressed and explained the rules of morality and distinguished between morality and immorality. This is Surah An-Nur. In it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes His nur as well. And remember one thing, if we are to lower our gaze for the sake of Allah, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, wallahi, He will grant us a nur on our faces in the dunya as well as in the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to lower our gaze for His sake. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains the punishment of an adultering man and an adulteress, a woman who has committed adultery. Thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains one of the other kaba'ir al-dhunub, one of the greatest sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَأْتُوا بِأَرْبَعَةِ شُهَدَاءَ فَاجْلِدُوهُمْ. Those who accuse the believing women of immorality and adultery, those who accuse people of adultery, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you should lash them as a form of punishment and never accept their witness in anything unless they declare their repentance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from accusing people. Here after this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then explains the incident of Aisha radiallahu anha, wherein Na'udhu billah, she was accused by some of the munafiqeen after Ghazwatu Bani al-Mustaliq. There was an incident where she had lost or she had misplaced a piece of her jewelry and she remained behind, and it so happened that the army, the rest of them continued and she was alone. One of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Safwan ibn Mu'attal radiallahu anhu, he assisted her all the way back to Madinatul Munawwara. When the munafiqeen saw her, they accused her, Na'udhu billah. Who was she? She was one of the best women to ever tread this earth after the Anbiya alayhi. Aisha, as-Siddiqa radiallahu anha, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anha, being accused, na'udhu billah, of immorality. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the other companions were waiting for wahi. They were waiting for revelation. This revelation did not come for a long period of time. In the meantime, some of the people spread this accusation, na'udhu billah. And Allah has cursed them and Allah has admonished them. Some of them, they said, no ways, this is not true. Look at who we are. If we cannot do this, Aisha radiallahu anha is better than us. Na'udhu billah, she is indeed free from this. And the third group of the people, from the very outset, they did not want to listen regarding this accusation. Hada ifkum mubin. This is indeed a lie. We are not supposed to be speaking about these things. So the people fell into three groups. Thereafter, wahi came. After there was a long pause, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam remained silent. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu remained silent until one day Jibreel alayhi salam came down with the verses. Innal ladhina ja'u bil ifki. Indeed, those who came with the accusation, The word ifk is used, accusation. As soon as the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, as soon as they heard the word accusation, there was a sigh of relief. Why? They knew that this means that whatever was leveled against Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu anha was indeed a lie and it was false. Thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُحِبُّونَ أَن تَشِيعَ الْفَاحِشَةُ فِي الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. Those who like to spread tales of immorality among the believing men and women, for them is a severe punishment in the dunya and the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from spreading tales, whether they are true or false. False, if we have a genuine feeling for someone and we clearly have evidence against them, there is a method of rectifying it without disgracing them. And if we really have a genuine feeling for them, we will help them without disgracing them. Man satara musliman satarahu Allahu fid dunya wal akhirah. Whoever covers the aib or the ill of a believing male or female, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cover their ills in the dunya as well as in the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not expose us. I had mentioned a few nights ago, if we were to walk on the streets and everyone could see how much water we were in, maybe we would be remaining at home and we wouldn't even come out of the houses. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that no one knows how much sin the other person is engaged in and no one knows how much good the other one is engaged in. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purify us, keep us away from rumor, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us pure and always in the highest levels of morality, as well as our children and offspring. Ameen. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to mention, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. O you who believe, do not follow the paths of shaitan. Don't follow the roads that shaitan has laid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from shaitan. وَمَن يَتَّبِعْ خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. Whosoever follows the paths of shaitan, the roads of shaitan, the footsteps of shaitan, فَإِنَّهُ يَأْمُرُ بِالْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. That person indeed will begin to order and command that which is immoral and evil. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us once again from immorality and from evil. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the rulings about going into someone's home. Ya أيها الذين آمنوا, O you who believe, لا تدخلوا بيوتا غير بيوتكم. Do not enter houses besides your own houses. حتى تستأنسوا وتسلموا على أهلها. Until you make yourself known and until you greet the people within the home, until you have permission to enter that home. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the very next verse says, وَإِن قِيلَ لَكُمْ ارْجِعُوا فَارْجِعُوا هُوَ أَزْكَى لَكُمْ. If you are told, go away, you should go away, it's better for you. Let's think upon this verse for a moment. If you arrived at someone's house, knocked, and they told you to go away, how would you feel? This shows us that our iman is so weak. The Quran says, if you are told to go away, it's better for you. It must not make you hate the person. Maybe that is not the right time to visit them. Today, if we visited someone, we are not bothered, we are not worried. We have telephones, we could actually phone them to inform them we are coming, but we don't do that. What do? We barge in and we walk straight to the back. This is against the etiquettes of the Sharia. We need to walk from the front door. Remember, there may be males or females within the house, especially the females. And it is incorrect for us to barge in right at the back, and we may not be mahram, earning a sin in the process. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from immorality. And I know nowadays no one would actually tell us, look, I am at home, but go away and come back later. There might be just a few. But if they are doing so, they are not wrong. The Quran says they have the right to do so. And every single one of you have the right to do so as well. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions regarding the lowering of the gaze. He starts off with the lowering of the gaze of the males before the females. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ. Say, tell the believing males to lower their gazes and to protect their chastity, their private parts. Allahu Akbar. Many a time we feel that hijab is only for the women. Hijab, there is a different type of hijab for men. What is that? That is the lowering of the gaze from the very first. From the beginning, we see something, immediately we should lower our gaze for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember, this is Surah An-Nur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us nur if we fulfill His commands for His sake. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us about the believing women and commands them. وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ The same command. يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ They too should lower their gazes. This does not mean that once we have a niqab on our faces, now we can see whatever we want with these beady eyes of ours. No, it does not mean that. It means even with that niqab, we should ensure and we should make sure that we look down and we lower our gazes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the true understanding. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the verse that I had read at the beginning, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا And turn to Allah, all of you, all believing male and females. Why? لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ So that you can achieve success. Success in the dunya as well as success in the akhirah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains a very important verse. He is describing the darkness of the deeds of the kuffar and the fact that they are dark, so dark. Remember, this is Surah An-Nur, and Allah is giving you a comparison of the darkness so that you can appreciate the light. He mentions in one of the verses, Allahu nuru samawati wal ard. Indeed, Allah is the nur of the skies and the earth. And then a few verses later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is comparing that to the darknesses of the deeds of the kuffar. And he says, they are similar to the darknesses within the deep sea. The deep sea whereby you will find a wave, on top of it another wave, and on top of it a cloud. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the deeper you go, you will find darknesses one on top of the other. For indeed, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken the light away from something or someone, no one can bring light back to that thing or that person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here in these verses is explaining a very important point. A few years ago, the University of Oklahoma, the scientists decided to go out into the oceans. And they went out into the deep oceans and they made two discoveries. The first discovery was that in the deep oceans, they found that there are two waves. There is an undercurrent as well as a current at the top. And on top of that, there is a cloud normally. So how did they find this out? A very simple experiment. I'm sure some of us, if we go to Durban or somewhere where there is a deep ocean and go further in, we will also pick up the same. If you release two ropes with different lengths, one higher and one lower, you will notice that one will be flowing in the other direction, and the other one, the lower one, will be going in the total opposite direction. This is the power of Allah. They discovered it some decades ago, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned it in the Quran in this verse 1400 years ago. The continuation of this verse, when they went out into the deep oceans with a submarine, they noticed at a certain level, suddenly everything that was red became black. They were amazed. They began to record that this is a discovery. Everything red lost color. And after another period, after another gap, everything orange lost color. And then everything yellow lost color. And then everything green lost color at different intervals. They were amazed. When they wrote it, they thought that they were the ones who had discovered it. In fact, right at the bottom, when all the colors of the spectrum, and I'm sure we know the spectrum, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, and red. When all the colors were lost, one of them actually said, I can barely see my hand. They recorded all this. When they came up, they found that before they could mention that it was their discovery, one of the Muslimin had already mentioned, this is mentioned in the Quran, when you go down into the deep oceans, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there are darknesses one on top of the other. So the darkness of red is on top of the darkness of orange, the darkness of orange is on top of the darkness of yellow, and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَجْعَلِ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُورًا فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ نُورٍ If Allah has decided there will be no nur for something, indeed there will definitely be no nur. The creator of the color red decided that at that point it will disappear. The creator of the color orange decided that at that point it will disappear. They discovered it a few decades ago. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had it recorded in the Quran 1400 years ago. These are the miracles of the Quran. We have just mentioned one, but Wallahi, the Quran is full of these miracles. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand how fortunate we are to be from amongst the ummah of the Quran. Ameen. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Furqan, that is the Surah, Al-Furqan is the Qur'an. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning what the kuffar said about the Qur'an. They tried to mention different things regarding the Qur'an. Why didn't the Qur'an come down all at once? Or they tried to mention that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, na'udhu billah, is not the ideal Prophet. The reason being, we see him in the markets. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions right at the end of this particular juz, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Every single messenger that we have sent. إِلَّا إِنَّهُمْ لَيَأْكُلُونَ الطَّعَامَ وَيَمْشُونَ فِي الْأَسْوَاقَ. They all ate food and they all walked in the markets. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand the power of the Quran. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.